The Philippines is considered one of the 17 megadiversity countries in the world when it comes to variety of ecosystems, species, and genetic resources. Many of the islands comprising our archipelago have a very high degree of plant and animal endemism. It is endowed with 52,177 species of wild flora and fauna, and at least 50% of this can only be found in the Philippines. Unfortunately, we are also considered as among the hottest of the hotspots of the world because we are ranked as 10th biodiversity hotspots in the world. Our forest cover is dwindling. Our coastal, marine, and freshwater systems are suffering degradation. Our endemic and unique species are still endangered. Philippine genetic resources are exploited and utilized by foreign entities, but our communities and our country have yet to share the benefits derived from these. The problem of illegal wildlife trade in the Philippines is but a mirror image of what each of us face in the global crisis of illegal wildlife trade. The Philippines loses at least 50 billion pesos a year due to illegal wildlife trade alone. These include revenue that should have been paid by illegal wildlife collectors and traders, the market value of the resources involved, the ecological role of the wild collected resources, and the damage to the habitats incurred during poaching. Beyond the numbers and monetary equivalents, what is more alarming is the increased risk on people, their livelihoods, their communities, and their habitats. My hometown, a small island province of Occidental Mindoro, just south of Manila, is the home to Philippine tamarau, a species of water buffalo, which can only be found in my island and nowhere else in the world. Despite of our ardent efforts to protect the tamarau and its habitat, it is still among the most critically endangered species in the world. While we are seeing a slow increase in its population, its 523 head count means that more concerted efforts need to be done. Because of the twin problems of biodiversity loss and illegal wildlife trade, the Philippines has been actively participating in international conferences with the aim of mobilizing support for biodiversity conservation and combating illegal wildlife trade. The Philippines participated in the London Conference on Illegal Wildlife Trade in February of 2014. And the follow-up conference in Hanoi in November of 2016. The Philippines has been stepping up its efforts to fulfill our commitments to the London Declaration. Allow me to highlight some of the key initiatives that we are working on. First, the Philippines continues to work to eradicate the market for illegal wildlife products. The Philippines is the first non-elephant range country and the first in the Asian region, if not in the whole of Asia, to destroy the government stockpile on illegal elephant ivory. This bold step was done in June of 2013, where more than 4 tons of ivory were crushed and burned. We wanted to send a clear message. The Philippines values live elephants with tusks intact than ivories from elephants that have been killed. This is also to ensure that ivory contrabands can no longer be used for illegal commercial use. The Philippines succeeded in sending this message. As of 2018, At least 19 countries and states have followed suit and destroyed part of their stockpiles of illegal ivory. As a constant reminder that the fight against illegal ivory trade must continue to rage on, an elephant sculpture partly made of ash remains of the burnt ivory has been constructed in one of our parks in the Philippines. In the past, courier service providers, whether to their knowledge or not, were being used to transport illegal wildlife. But now, they are our partners in combating illegal wildlife trade in the Philippines. We started this partnership with the Philippine Postal Corporation, a government-controlled postal company with 1,383 offices nationwide, and the JRS Express, a private courier company with more than 400 branches nationwide. Both are now strictly implementing inspection of all packages and will refuse cargoes and parcels containing wildlife without the accompanying proper permits from the Philippine government. The Philippine government is now working with other courier service providers to expand this kind of partnership. We have also launched the Stop Illegal Wildlife Trade campaign, targeting agencies and private entities operating in major air and sea ports. These include airline companies, boat and vessel operators, cargo forwarders, and courier service providers. To date, the campaign has covered 20 air and seaports all over the Philippines. Second, the Philippines is stepping up its wildlife law enforcement actions. We are currently rolling out the Philippine Wildlife Law Enforcement Action Plan. This is our national roadmap to address wildlife crimes for the next 10 years, from 2018 to 2028. It will also serve as a guide in prioritizing enforcement actions, fund sourcing, resource allocation, and evaluating the impacts of enforcement work in the Philippines. In order to effectively implement this, the Philippine Operations Group on Ivory and Illegal Wildlife Trade, a composite team of national agencies, and the law enforcement units has been activated. This group has been in the forefront of addressing ivory smuggling, transborder poaching, and illegal trade in wildlife in the Philippines. I am proud to mention that no illegal shipment of elephant ivory has entered the Philippine territory for the last 9 years. But undoubtedly, illegal wildlife trade still persists. Thus, the Philippines recognizes that illegal wildlife trade is no longer just an environmental crime. This is more than just poaching, illegal collection and hunting of rare, endemic, and endangered species and wildlife. We strongly believe that illegal wildlife trade is a transnational crime, alongside with illegal drugs, arms, and human trafficking. It is not an attack against just one country or one region. It is an attack against all of us, especially against our children and their future. With the global crisis as big as illegal wildlife trade, the Philippines is adopting the Bayanihan strategy. What is Bayanihan? The root word of Bayanihan means hero. In the olden times, in the Philippine rural villages, houses were made of nipa and bamboo. such that when families would want to relocate from one village to another, the entire community is mobilized to literally carry on their shoulders and move the family home. Bayanihan taps on the individual's sense of community and camaraderie. It recognizes that each and every member of the community plays an important role in achieving a common goal. This concept of bayanihan inculcate in the Filipinos a sense and concept of heroism. Bayanihan espouses a collaborative, collective, and results-driven whole-of-government approach to combating illegal wildlife trade. Bayanihan celebrates our connectedness. It is a paradigm that facilitates synergy and collaboration, unity in purpose, and collective action. The Philippine Bayanihan strategy will build on the gains from the previous actions and will upscale its fight against illegal wildlife trade on two levels. The first level, at the legislative. I, as a representative and member of Philippine Congress, have filed a bill to revise and update our wildlife conservation law. The enactment of this law will enable the Philippines to be more in step with our commitments to the Convention on International Trade in Endangered Species of Wild Fauna and Flora, the Convention on Biological Diversity, the Convention on Migratory Species, and the London Declaration. This will be a key legislation on the protection of wildlife and their habitats, and on the fair and equitable sharing of the benefits arising out of the utilization of genetic resources from wildlife. This law institutionalizes coordinated law enforcement among national and local governments and law enforcement agencies. It expands the scope of prohibited acts, including wildlife laundering. It will provide stricter fines and penalties for violators and perpetually bans erring government officials and employees from public service. And to ensure effective implementation, yearly appropriations will be allocated in the Philippine national budget. Secondly, at executive level, a draft executive order creating the National Anti-Wildlife Crime Council is being finalized. In the spirit of Bayanihan, the Philippine Executive Branch is pitching in to immediately convene the National Anti-Wildlife Council that will be directly under the supervision and control of the Office of the President. This council will be composed of national agencies, the Philippine National Police, and the Armed Forces of the Philippines. Coordinated law enforcement against illegal wildlife trade as a transnational crime is a council's primary task. The draft order is now undergoing review and finalization and will be submitted for the approval of our President, President Rodrigo Duterte. Combating illegal wildlife trade is a challenge that each and every country here must conquer. I urge countries in our own region, the Southeast Asia, and all other regions of the world to institute and initiate a regional initiative to ensure a collaborative and connected response against illegal wildlife trade. As Leonardo da Vinci said, everything connects to everything else. Our choices have great and lasting impact on each other and our respective countries in this generation and the next. We can help Plan A, Plan B, Plan C to to plan Z, but there is only one planet Earth. For all of us, there is no planet B. So let us become heroes of our own time and fight illegal wildlife trade for ourselves, for our children, and our children's children. Thank you.